Good day, Israelites. My name is Brother Greg Qualls. Welcome back to Talking with Israel. Lean not on your own understanding. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your paths straight. The Bible defines understanding this way: the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10. Let's take a look at a somewhat extreme but a real look at a man of God who ultimately had no understanding. In my Bible, the NASB, the warning and the sin of the prophet is how they've entitled this passage. It's from 1 Kings chapter 13. The warning is given by the prophet to King Jeroboam, but I'd like us to look at the sin, and we'll pick it up at verse 7. Then the king said to the man of God, "Come home with me and refresh yourself, and I will give you a gift." But the man of God said to the king, "If you were to give me half your house, I would not go with you, nor would I eat bread or drink water in this place. For so it was commanded me by the word of the Lord, saying, 'You shall not eat bread nor drink water, nor return by the way that you came.'" So he went another way and did not return by the way that he had come to Bethel. Now an old prophet was living in Bethel, and his sons came in and told him all the deeds which the man of God had done that day in Bethel, the words which he had spoken to the king. These also they reported to their father. And their father said to them, "Which way did he go?" Now his sons had seen the way that the man of God who came from Judah had gone. Then he said to his sons, "Saddle the donkey for me." So they saddled the donkey for him, and he rode away on it. So he went after the man of God and found him sitting under an oak. And he said to him, "Are you the man of God who came from Judah?" And he said, "I am." Then he said to him, "Come home with me and eat bread." But he said, "I cannot return with you, nor come with you, nor will I eat bread or drink water with you in this place. For a command came to me by the word of the Lord, 'You shall not eat bread nor drink water there. Do not return by going the way that you came.'" Then he said to him, "I too am a prophet like you. And an angel spoke to me by the word of the Lord, saying, 'Bring him back with you to your house so that he may eat bread and drink water.' But he lied to him. So he went back with him and ate bread in his house and drank water." Now it came about as they were sitting down at the table that the word of the Lord came to the prophet who had brought him back. And he cried out to the man of God who came from Judah, saying, "This is what the Lord says. Because you have disobeyed the command of the Lord and have not kept the commandment which the Lord your God commanded you, but have returned and eaten bread and drunk water in the place of which he said to you, 'You are not to eat bread nor drink water,' your dead body will not come to the grave of your fathers." It came about after he had eaten bread and after he had drunk that he saddled the donkey for him for the prophet whom he had brought back. Now, when he had gone, a lion met him on the way and killed him, and his body was thrown on the road with the donkey standing beside it. The lion also was standing beside the body. And behold, men passed by and saw the body thrown on the road and the lion standing beside the body. So they came and told about it in the city where the old prophet had lived. Now, when the prophet who had brought him back from the way heard about it, he said, "It is the man of God who disobeyed the command of the Lord. Therefore, the Lord has given him to the lion, which has torn him and killed him, in accordance with the word of the Lord which he spoke to him." Then he spoke to his son, saying, "Saddle the donkey for me." And they saddled it. Then he went and found his body thrown on the road with the donkey and the lion standing beside the body. The lion had not eaten the body nor harmed the donkey. So the prophet picked up the body of the man of God and laid it on the donkey and brought it back. And he came to the city of the old prophet to mourn and to bury him. He laid his body in his own grave, and they mourned over him, saying, "Oh, my brother." And after he had buried him, he talked to his son, saying, "When I die, bury me in the grave in which the man of God is buried. Lay my bones beside his bones." It's clear to me that the man of God, even though he had been given specific instructions, he had made a decision based on his own understanding that a prophet can basically overrule God, which showed that he had absolutely no understanding. No matter who causes you to break the commandment, when you break the commandment, the penalty is death.
The second death.
Sunday churchgoers, that may be what your leaders want. They may want you to die. Remember the word, "Therefore it is not surprising if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness." Some of those false prophets want you to die. You are victims already of creeping compromise, compromising the word of God for yourself. Yes, selfishness is what is guiding you, not the word of God. I mean, if the word of God meant anything, then you'd have gone to your pastor right after reading Genesis chapter 2, verse 3, and asking your pastor, "Why are we meeting on the first day?" No, his word is not important. And the Sunday churches, by and large, do not want you to read his word. They'll come out and point out a few scriptures that have nothing to do with one's own salvation. Then they'll talk for an hour, taking time, of course, to collect the tithes. They'll have an altar call where they'll tell people looking for real salvation, that if they just believe in Jesus and believe that he died for your sins, then you are saved. They'll come up and believe it. And the pastor will read a scripture saying, "He who hears my voice and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come into judgment, but has passed out of death into life." And everybody's shouting and hugging and welcoming them into their church. They will offer you no instruction, no admonishment to keep living by the commandments, no wisdom at all in how to walk with God. They will offer nothing of substance to help sustain those people on a daily basis, like reading and doing the word. But thank you, Jesus, for your patience. And thank you, Father, for your people who are listening and for giving me the chance to properly instruct your people in the way of understanding so that they can also be fearful and wise. Fear. That is one characteristic of the Hebrew people that simply is not evident in the world. We fear God. We fear him because we believe him. We believe in every word of the Bible. We know that his holy word has been given and has been sustained because of his spirit and because of his sovereignty. We know the flood happened. We know about the world's rulership. Daniel told us that. We believe in the rest of what the word tells us, and especially about our end. Therefore, we earnestly seek to please him. He is indeed a terrible God to those who hate him. And you hate him by disobeying him. While we believe every word in the Bible, both about the past, and it tells us about the present, and it tells us about the future, the world seems to think that God is not the same God that is in that book. That he has compromised himself and has changed with the times. That, despite what he himself has told us, they believe that he is not the same yesterday, today, and forever. Well, if you look at the world, I actually think that to them there really is no God. And the few people who have a little faith and are looking for Christ's return and looking for some sweet Jesus to come, when his word says that the blood of those slain upon his return will be up to the horses' bridles for a distance of 200 miles, that is why God demands that his people are instructed and wise. And another reason is because if there are any righteous among us, we will be judging the angels. will be leaders in Jesus' kingdom, so we must judge correctly. And how can one do so without wisdom and instruction? The words wisdom and instruction complement each other because wisdom means skill and instruction means discipline. No skill is perfected without discipline. This book deals with the most fundamental skill of all, practical righteousness before God in every area of life. This requires knowledge, experience, and a willingness to put God first. And that's a problem that humans have, putting God first. We are always first. He is our creator. It sort of blows my mind that we wake up every day and we don't think about our creator. We think about us. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. And the beginning of wisdom, acquire wisdom. And with all your acquiring, get understanding. For the Lord gives wisdom, from his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 6. The book of Proverbs and the book of Ecclesiastes will greatly assist your growth in wisdom and understanding. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride and arrogance, and the evil way, and the perverted mouth I hate. Counsel is mine, and sound wisdom. I am understanding. Power is mine. I love those who love me, and those who diligently seek me will find me. That's Proverbs chapter 8, verses 13, 14, and 17. So that's your assignment. Read those books, Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. Your spirit will be glad that you did. May God bless you and keep you, and amaze you as you abide in him. Thank you for listening. God willing, we'll join you next week right here on Talking with Israel.